Hello everyone, welcome to this session on muscles of the lower limb. Okay, in this session we'll be revising all the muscles of the lower limb. So total in all, how many muscles are there in the lower limb? Okay, answer to this question you'll get at the end of the session, so please watch the video completely. Okay, and any muscle when we describe under these four headings: proximal attachment, distal attachment, nerve supply and action of the muscle. So we'll be covering these headings for all the muscles of the lower limb. Okay, except for the muscles of the foot, in which we'll be discussing only the location of the muscles as well as the nerve supply of the muscles. So let's start with the muscles of the anterior compartment of the thigh. So here is the list of the muscles of the anterior compartment of the thigh. So we'll discuss each muscle one by one. First muscle listed here is sartorius. So again, all these muscles will be discussing under these headings. Okay. For sartorius, proximal attachment is from an area on the hip bone which is referred to as anterior superior iliac spine. Okay. Then distal attachment is along the upper medial aspect of the tibia. In the upper medial aspect of the tibia, there are two other muscles as well which we'll be learning later on. Names of those muscles are gracilis and semitendinosus. Okay. So these three muscles together, they attach along the upper medial aspect of the tibia. So proximal attachment, distal attachment we have covered. Nerve supply of sartorius is by the femoral nerve. To be more specific, it is the anterior division of the femoral nerve. Okay. Then action of sartorius. Sartorius causes flexion at the hip joint as well as flexion at the knee joint. Then there are four muscles which are studied together. Here we see the four muscles: rectus femoris, vastus medialis, vastus lateralis and vastus intermedius. These four muscles are grouped together and they are called as quadriceps femoris. Let's start with the rectus femoris first. Proximal attachment for rectus femoris, it is by two heads of origin. The straight head of rectus femoris arises from the anterior inferior iliac spine, and reflected head arises from an area above the acetabulum. When we see on the lateral aspect of this hip bone, there'll be a small area above the acetabulum for the reflected head of the rectus femoris. Okay. Then distal attachment of all these four muscles are learned together because their primary insertion is on the patella, and from there there is a ligament which is called as ligamentum patellae, which extends up to the tibial tuberosity. Okay. Then nerve supply is by the femoral nerve for all these four muscles: rectus femoris, vastus medialis, lateralis, vastus intermedius, all supplied by femoral nerve. To be more specific, it is the posterior division of the femoral nerve. Okay. Then action of rectus femoris is it causes flexion at the hip joint and extension at the knee joint. Okay. It is acting on hip joint because it is crossing the hip joint. But when we see the other muscles, vastus medialis, lateralis and intermedius, they don't cross the hip joint. That's why their action will be only on the knee joint. Okay. So what is the proximal attachment of these muscles? For vastus medialis, vastus lateralis, here we can see there is an area which is called as intertrochanteric line. Near the upper aspect of the intertrochanteric line, just lateral to it, there is vastus lateralis. And near the lower aspect, there is vastus medialis. And they also have attachment on the linea aspera. Lateral lip will be for vastus lateralis. Medial lip will be for vastus medialis. Okay. So we have covered proximal attachment, distal attachment, nerve supply, and actions of these four muscles. Okay. Then articularis genu, it's a small slip of muscle which is attached onto the lower 1/4 of the anterior surface of the femur. Distal attachment, it will go up to the suprapatellar bursa. It actually pulls the suprapatellar bursa and it keeps it intact. Okay. Nerve supply will be again by the femoral nerve. Okay. Then tensor fascia lata, proximal attachment is, it will be seen near the outer aspect of the iliac crest. Area which is 5 centimeters behind this anterior superior iliac spine, that area will be covered by tensor fascia lata muscle. Proximal attachment is here. Then distal attachment, it continues as the iliotibial tract which goes up to the lateral aspect of tibia. Okay. Nerve supply of tensor fascia lata is different from the other muscles. Nerve supply of tensor fascia lata is by the superior gluteal nerve. The nerve which supplies gluteus medius and minimus, that now supplies tensor fascia lata as well. Okay. And action of tensor fascia lata is, it will stabilize the knee joint, and it will help in extension at the knee joint as well. So these were the various muscles in the anterior compartment of the thigh. There's a small group of muscle which is called as vertebro-iliofemoral muscle. Three muscles are listed: psoas major, psoas minor, and iliacus. Psoas major, it arises from the transverse process of the lumbar vertebrae, the five lumbar vertebrae, the anterior aspect of the transverse process, as well as the intervertebral disc between the vertebrae. And psoas minor, it is rarely present. It may be present in 50% of the individuals, and if it is present, it will arise from the intervertebral disc between T12 and L1. Okay? And iliacus muscle, proximal attachment is from the iliac fossa. To be more specific, it is the upper 2/3 of the iliac fossa. Okay? And distal attachment of these muscles, they together form a tendon which is called as iliopsoas tendon, which gets attached along the lesser trochanter of the femur. Okay. So attachments are covered. Nerve supply for psoas major and psoas minor, these are directly from the lumbar nerves. And for iliacus, the nerve supply is by the trunk of the femoral nerve. Okay. Femoral nerve, before it divides into anterior and posterior division, it will supply the iliacus muscle. Then action of these muscles, they are the primary flexors at the hip joint. Okay. Chief flexion of the hip joint is done by psoas major, psoas minor, and iliacus muscle. Okay. Now let's cover the muscles of the medial compartment of the thigh. So here is the list of muscles in the medial compartment of the thigh. Three muscles we can remember together as adductor group of muscles: adductor longus, adductor brevis, and adductor magnus. And there are two other muscles: gracilis, pectineus. And there's one more muscle which is on a very deeper plane, that is obturator externus muscle. Okay. So if you see proximal attachment of these adductor muscles, it is on the pubis bone as well as the ischiopubic rami. Okay. So all this adductor longus, brevis, magnus, they are attached on the anterior surface of the pubis as well as on the ischiopubic rami. Then distal attachment of these muscles is most of the muscles gets attached onto the linea aspera. Okay. Specific attachment on the linea aspera you can study from the session of osteology of the lower limb, which I've already covered in this YouTube channel. Okay. Pectineus has got proximal attachment from the pectineal line, which is along the superior aspect here. And obturator externus will get attached along the outer aspect of the obturator membrane, as well as we can see some attachment on along the adjacent margins of this obturator foramen. Okay. Distal attachment of all these muscles are along the linea aspera, except this gracilis and obturator externus. Gracilis, I've told you, it has distal attachment along the upper medial aspect of the tibia, along with sartorius and semitendinosus. And obturator externus, it gets attached along an area along the inner aspect of the greater trochanter, which is referred to as trochanteric fossa. Okay. And pectineus, it gets attached slightly above the linea aspera into a line which is called as spiral line. Okay. The nerve supply of these muscles is by the obturator nerve. It's the nerve of the medial compartment of the thigh. But in this also, we should know that which division of obturator nerve supplies which muscle. The anterior division, it supplies adductor longus, gracilis, pectineus, and adductor brevis, if not supplied by posterior division. Okay. Adductor brevis, it may be supplied by anterior division, it may be supplied by posterior division. And adductor magnus and obturator externus, these two muscles are supplied by posterior division of the obturator nerve. And adductor magnus has got one more nerve supply by the tibial part of the sciatic nerve. Okay, that's why this muscle is also included in a group of muscle called as hybrid muscle or composite muscle. This pectineus muscle is also a hybrid muscle, which is supplied by this obturator nerve, as well as there is some contribution from the femoral nerve as well. Okay, so two hybrid muscles in this list: one is adductor magnus, another is pectineus. And actions of these muscles, so all these are adductors at the hip joint. Gracilis, in addition, will cause flexion at the knee joint as well. And obturator externus also helps in lateral rotation at the hip joint. Now let's start with the muscles of the gluteal region. So here is the list of muscles which are seen in the gluteal region. The largest of all the muscles is gluteus maximus. Okay. So here we can see this muscle is the gluteus maximus. And under the cover of gluteus maximus, there are multiple other muscles. Okay. So all these muscles will be covering now. So proximal attachment of gluteus maximus. If you have studied about the hip bone, you'll be able to answer this. On the posterior aspect of this iliac crest, there's an outer sloping surface for gluteus maximus, as well as it has got attachment from the sacrum, from the sacrotuberous ligament, and as well as some surface along the gluteal surface of the hip bone, the area behind the posterior gluteal line. Okay, so all these surfaces give proximal attachment to the gluteus maximus muscle. And distal attachment of gluteus maximus, you have to remember 3/4 and 1/4. So 3/4 of attachment is along the iliotibial tract and 1/4 of attachment is along the gluteal tuberosity. Okay, so maximum of the gluteus maximus is getting attached along the iliotibial tract. Okay, so through which it can have action on the knee joint as well. Okay, nerve supply of gluteus maximus is by the inferior gluteal nerve. Okay, whereas gluteus medius, minimus, those are supplied by superior gluteal nerve. Okay, so gluteus maximus is inferior gluteal nerve, and action of gluteus maximus, it is the chief extensor at the hip joint. Okay, so while standing up from sitting position, gluteus maximus is the chief extensor. And let's learn about this gluteus medius and gluteus minimus. So here we can see this muscle is gluteus medius and this muscle is gluteus minimus. Okay, so gluteus medius and minimus, they both are arising from the gluteal surface of the hip bone. Then distal attachment of gluteus medius and minimus, it's along the greater trochanter of the femur. Okay, gluteus minimus is more on the anterior aspect and gluteus medius is more on the lateral aspect of the greater trochanter. Nerve supply I've already covered, superior gluteal nerve for gluteus medius, minimus, as well as one more muscle, that is tensor fascia lata. Okay, so these three muscles supplied by superior gluteal nerve. Then actions of gluteus medius and minimus, anterior fibers are responsible for medial rotation and the lateral fibers are responsible for abduction at the hip joint. Okay, so medial rotation and abduction are the two actions of gluteus medius and minimus. Then piriformis, this muscle actually arises from the anterior aspect of the sacrum. There's an E-shaped origin for the piriformis, and from there it passes through the greater sciatic notch and distal attachment, it's along the tip of the greater trochanter of the femur. Okay, this piriformis, obturator internus, then two gamelli, quadratus femoris, all these are referred to as short lateral rotators of the hip joint. So whenever we speak about actions of these muscles, so we can say they will cause lateral rotation at the hip joint. Nerve supply for piriformis is nerve to piriformis. Okay. Then obturator internus, proximal attachment of obturator internus. Here we can see the inner aspect of the obturator membrane, as well as there is some attachment on the inner aspect of the ilium. Okay, from there this muscle crosses the lesser sciatic notch, and along with there are two muscles, superior gamellus and inferior gamellus, they arise from the adjacent margins of the lesser sciatic notch. Okay, from there distal attachment of these three muscles is on the inner aspect of the greater trochanter, just in front of the attachment of obturator externus muscle. Okay, obturator externus was on the trochanteric fossa. In front of the trochanteric fossa, these three muscles are there. Okay, these three muscles together are also referred to as tricipital tendon. Okay, also there is one more name for these three muscles together, they are also called as triceps coxae. Okay, coxa refers to the hip bone, so three muscles together here is referred to as triceps coxae. Then quadratus femoris, this muscle arises from the lateral aspect of the ischial tuberosity and it gets attached along the quadrate tubercle, which is along the intertrochanteric crest. the nerve supply of these muscles. For obturator internus, there is a specific nerve called as nerve to obturator internus. For quadratus femoris also, there is a nerve which is called as nerve to quadratus femoris. Okay? And for gamelus, superior inferior gamelus, we can remember nerve supply with the adjacent muscle. Superior gamelus is close to obturator internus. Superior gamelus is very close to obturator internus. That's why it is supplied by nerve to obturator internus. Okay? And inferior gamelus is very close to quadratus femoris. That's why this is supplied by nerve to quadratus femoris. Okay? So that's how we can remember nerve supply of these muscles. Actions I've already discussed. They are short lateral rotators at the hip joint. Now let's cover the muscles of the posterior compartment of the thigh. This compartment is also referred to as hamstring compartment, also referred to as flexor compartment of the thigh. So let's start with semitendinosus. Proximal attachment of semitendinosus is along with this muscle, biceps femoris muscle. Okay? You see the ischial tuberosity. Ischial tuberosity, there's an upper quadrangular part and there's a lower triangular part. Okay? In the upper quadrangular part, again we can divide into lateral and medial areas. The medial area gives attachment to the semitendinosus along with the long head of the biceps femoris. Okay? Then upper lateral part, it gives attachment to the semimembranosus muscles. Okay? And in the lower triangular part, further we can subdivide into a lateral part and a medial part. Lateral part gives attachment to the adductor magnus muscle. So this is the ischial part of the adductor magnus, and there is one part which is remaining that is referred to as the subcutaneous part. This is just covered by fibrofatty tissue. Okay. So if you learn about the ischial tuberosity, then proximal attachment of these muscles will be clear. Okay. Then distal attachment of these muscles, semitendinosus, semimembranosus, they go up to the tibia. Semitendinosus I've already covered, along with sartorius gracilis, along the upper medial aspect of the tibia. Then semimembranosus, it's also on the tibia, behind the medial condyle. There's a groove for semimembranosus. And biceps femoris proximal attachment I've already covered, along with semitendinosus. Distal attachment of biceps femoris is along the head of the fibula. Okay? So head of the fibula gives distal attachment for biceps femoris muscle. Adductor magnus, ischial part, has got proximal attachment here along the lower lateral part of the triangular area. Then for adductor magnus, distal attachment is along the adductor tubercle. There's an elevation. If you study about the femur, just above the medial condyle, there's an elevation which is called as adductor tubercle. Okay? And from there, there's a ligament which arises, which is referred to as tibial collateral ligament, also referred to as medial collateral ligament. When we learn about this posterior compartment of the thigh, we should know what are the characteristics of hamstring muscles. Okay, so for a muscle to be called as a hamstring, proximal attachment is from the ischial tuberosity, distal attachment is along the one of the bones of the leg, either tibia or fibula, then nerve supplies by the tibial part of the sciatic nerve, and action is extension at the hip joint and flexion at the knee joint. Okay, so these are the characteristics of hamstrings. And amongst these, semitendinosus and semimembranosus, these are referred to as true hamstrings, okay? Because they qualify all the criteria of the hamstring muscles, okay? So why these two muscles are not qualifying all criteria? Because the proximal attachment of biceps femoris is represented by this ligament, sacrotuberous ligament, okay? And for adductor magnus, it is not included in true hamstring because the muscle itself is not going up to the bone of the leg. Okay, it's the extension from the adductor tubercle, which is called as tibial collateral ligament, which goes up to the tibia. Okay, that's why these two muscles are not included in true hamstrings. So this was all about the posterior compartment of the thigh. So let's start with the anterior compartment of the leg. So there are four muscles listed in the anterior compartment of the leg. So let's start with tibialis anterior first. Proximal attachment of tibialis anterior. Here we can see in the bone, the proximal attachment is seen. This is the lateral surface of the tibia. So here we can see the lateral surface of the tibia. Maximum area gives attachment to the tibialis anterior muscle. Then distal attachment of tibial is anterior. It goes up to the base of the first metatarsal. Okay, it's actually on along the inferomedial aspect of the base of first metatarsal as well as the medial cuneiform bone. Okay, the word inferomedial is important because in the same bone along the inferolateral part there is one muscle attached that is called as fibularis longus. Okay, so this was distal attachment. Then nerve supply of all the four muscles is by the deep fibular nerve. Sciatic nerve divides into two nerves, which is called as tibial nerve and common fibular nerve. And common fibular nerve divides into two nerves. Those are deep fibular nerve and superficial fibular nerve. Okay, deep fibular nerve supplies the muscles of the anterior compartment of the leg, and superficial fibular nerve supplies muscles of the lateral compartment of the leg. Okay, then action of tibialis anterior is dorsiflexion at the ankle joint, as well as it will help in inversion of the foot. Okay, the two special movements in the foot called as inversion and eversion. So tibialis anterior helps in inversion. Then talking about these muscles, extensor digitorum longus, extensor hallucis longus and fibularis tertius, all the three muscles have got proximal attachment from the fibula. Okay, so in the fibula there is a surface which is called as medial surface or extensor surface of the fibula, from which these three muscles are arising. Extensor digitorum longus has got an extensive origin from the fibula. That means it is attached along the upper part as well as the middle 2/4 as well. Okay, along the anterior aspect of the middle 2/4 as well. The maximum area is covered by this muscle, extensor digitorum longus. Then the middle 2/4 part along the posterior aspect, the muscle is extensor hallucis longus. And fibularis tertius will be seen along the lower 1/4 part of the fibula. Okay, distal attachment of these muscles are as per their name. Since the name is digitorum, it will go up to the lateral 4 digits, and hallucis it will go up to the hallux. Hallux means great toe. So distal phalanx, base of the distal phalanx of great toe is extensor hallucis longus, and base of the distal phalanx of lateral 4 toes is extensor digitorum longus. Okay, here also we have to specify the surface, dorsal surface or plantar surface, because these muscles are attached along the dorsal surface, and along the plantar surface the muscles will be flexor digitorum longus and flexor hallucis longus. Okay, and fibularis tertius has got attachment along the base of the fifth metatarsal bone. Okay, actions of other three muscles are also included in dorsiflexion at the ankle joint. Okay, so this was about the muscles in the anterior compartment of the leg. Now let's learn about the muscles of the lateral compartment of the leg. In the lateral compartment there are two muscles, fibularis longus and fibularis brevis. Their older names are peroneus longus and peroneus brevis. Okay, as per the recent edition of books, we should know these names, fibularis longus and fibularis brevis. Since the name is fibularis longus, fibularis brevis, the proximal attachment is from the fibula bone. On the fibula, on the lateral surface of the fibula, the upper part as well as the posterior aspect of the middle part, supposing this is the lateral surface of the fibula, the upper part as well as the posterior surface of the middle part, this will be fibularis longus. Okay, and anterior surface of the middle part and the lower part, the muscle is fibularis brevis. Okay, then distal attachment of these muscles, fibularis longus I discussed along with tibialis anterior, right? It actually crosses all the metatarsals and it goes up to the first metatarsal, base of the first metatarsal, but the area is inferolateral part along with the medial cuneiform bone. Okay, so that is fibularis longus. And while it crosses, it goes under a groove just below the cuboid bone. Okay, there's a groove below the cuboid bone for the tendon of fibularis longus muscle. And fibularis brevis, distal attachment is along the base of the fifth metatarsal. Okay, base of fifth metatarsal, one more muscle which we had covered was fibularis tertius. Nerve supply of these muscles is by the superficial fibular nerve. Okay, then actions of these muscles will cause eversion. In the foot, I told you there are two special actions, inversion and eversion, and the lateral aspect of the foot is raised. That action is referred to as eversion, and fibularis longus and brevis, they help in eversion of the foot. Okay. Now let's cover about the muscles along the posterior compartment of the leg. So in the posterior compartment, we can divide into two groups. One is the superficial group and other is the deep group. Okay, superficial group has got three muscles and deep group has got four muscles. Okay, first learn about these three muscles which are in the superficial posterior compartment. So these are gastrocnemius, soleus and plantaris. Gastrocnemius has got two heads of origin. So here we can see this is the medial head of the gastrocnemius, lateral head of the gastrocnemius. The proximal attachment is from the femur. Okay, above the medial condyle there is medial supracondylar line, above the lateral condyle there will be lateral supracondylar line. So in that region these muscles are attached, and along with the lateral head of gastrocnemius, plantaris also takes origin. Okay, and distal attachment of these muscles is by a common tendon which is referred to as tendo achillis or achillis tendon. Okay, which gets attached along the calcaneus bone. And gastrocnemius, the two heads of the gastrocnemius and soleus, these together they are called as triceps surae. Okay. The word sura refers to the calf region. Okay. So gastrocnemius and soleus together are referred to as triceps surae. Plantar is a muscle having a short belly and a long tendon. Okay, very small belly will be seen near the popliteal fossa, and the rest of the muscle looks at first impression it will look like a nerve, but if we trace it in the proximal aspect we'll find the muscle belly. So that is plantaris muscle. Distal attachment, it will merge with the tendo achillis. Okay, the nerve supply of these muscles. So nerve supply in general, we can remember nerve supply of the three superficial as well as the four deep muscles, it is by the tibial nerve. Okay, so all seven muscles are supplied by tibial nerve, and action of these muscles, they will cause plantar flexion at the ankle joint. Okay, so now let's learn about the deep muscles. So deep muscles, they are four in number. Here we can see. So these deep muscles, we can compare with the muscles in the anterior compartment of the leg. In the anterior compartment, there was tibialis anterior. So here there is tibialis posterior. Similarly for other two, flexor digitorum longus and flexor hallucis longus. Okay, one muscle extra we have to remember, that is popliteus. In the anterior compartment, there was fibularis tertius, which doesn't have any corresponding muscle here. Okay, so in that place we can remember popliteus. So let's learn about proximal attachment of these muscles. Tibialis posterior, here we can see it has got attachment from the tibia as well as from the fibula. Okay, this area which is shown, this is tibialis posterior, and among these two, one muscle is from tibia and one muscle is from fibula. So how to remember it? Tibia is the medial bone, but it gives attachment to the lateral muscle. Okay, among these two, which will be the lateral muscle? Right, digitorum longus will be the lateral muscle because hallux is on the medial aspect. Okay, so this a slight cross which you can remember. Tibia being a medial bone gives attachment to the lateral muscle. So this attachment which we can see, this is of the flexor digitorum longus, and this attachment we can see, this attachment is of the flexor hallucis longus. Okay, popliteus muscle has got attachment along the lateral condyle of the femur. Then distal attachment of these muscles, tibialis posterior, the primary attachment of tibialis posterior is along a bone of the tarsal group which is called as navicular bone. In the navicular bone there is an elevation which is called as navicular tuberosity. Okay, its primary insertion is along the navicular tuberosity, then it gives slips to all the tarsal bones except talus, and then finally it gets attached along the base of the middle three metatarsal bones. Then flexor digitorum longus, flexor hallucis longus, we can remember similar to extensor digitorum longus and extensor hallucis longus. For extensors there was dorsal surface, for flexors there will be plantar surface of the distal phalanx. Okay, and for popliteus, there's an area on the posterior surface of the tibia above the soleal line, that triangular area is for popliteus muscle. Okay, and again actions of these muscles is the plantar flexion at the ankle joint. Popliteus has got a different action. It is the chief unlocker of the knee joint. Okay, in the knee joint there is one action called as locking of the knee joint and unlocking of the knee joint. Popliteus helps in unlocking of the knee joint. Okay, now let's start with the muscles of the foot region. Okay, in the foot are divided into two groups, dorsum of foot and sole of foot. In the dorsum of foot there is only one muscle, that is extensor digitorum brevis. Okay, so here this muscle which we can see, this is extensor digitorum brevis. So in the foot we are not learning about the various attachments, we will just identify the muscles and we'll describe the nerve supply of those muscles. Okay, so extensor digitorum brevis we can see in the dorsum of the foot, and there is one thing specific about this muscle is the medial most slip, it gets separated out early, and this slip is also referred to as the extensor hallucis brevis muscle. Okay, so extensor hallucis brevis, it is not a separate muscle, it is a part of extensor digitorum brevis muscle only. Okay, so the medial most slip of extensor digitorum brevis is referred to as extensor hallucis brevis. Okay, and nerve supplies deep fibular nerve. Okay, deep fibular nerve supplies muscles of the anterior compartment of the leg. The same nerve will continue along the dorsum of the foot as well. So now let's start with the muscles along the sole of the foot. So in the sole of the foot there are four layers of muscles. We'll learn each layer one by one. Okay, in the first layer there are three muscles: abductor hallucis muscle. So in this image we can see this muscle is the abductor hallucis muscle, because we can see the hallux is here. Hallux means the great toe. Then flexor digitorum brevis muscle, this muscle which we can see, which is splitting into the tendons for the digits, this muscle is flexor digitorum brevis muscle, and this muscle is the abductor digiti minimi muscle. Okay, and for nerve supply, because this muscle is on the lateral aspect, this will be supplied by the lateral plantar nerve. Okay, and the other two muscles, those are more along the medial aspect, supplied by the medial plantar nerve. Okay, these plantar nerves are branched from the tibial nerve. Okay, so tibial nerve, its terminal branches are medial and lateral plantar nerve, and this division occurs approximately at the level of the tarsal tunnel. Okay, when the tibial nerve enters the foot, it divides into these two nerves. Muscles of the first layer we can compare with the muscles of the third layer. Okay, later on we'll compare it. So now let's see the muscles along the second layer of the sole. Here we can see the muscles along the second layer of the sole of the foot. I've listed down five muscles, amongst which four are lumbricals, and flexor accessorius is the fifth muscle. Okay, so lumbricals are seen getting attached along the tendons of the flexor digitorum longus muscle. Okay, and flexor accessorius, this muscle which we can see, this is the flexor accessorius muscle, also referred to as quadratus plantae muscle. Okay, and nerve supply of these muscles, only the first lumbrical, this muscle is supplied by the medial plantar nerve. Rest of the muscles are supplied by lateral plantar nerve. Okay, so maximum muscles in this second layer, they are supplied by lateral plantar nerve. Okay, except the first lumbrical. Let's see the muscles along the third layer. So here we can see flexor hallucis brevis muscle. Here we can see this is the flexor hallucis brevis muscle. Similarly, there is a muscle here, flexor digiti minimi brevis muscle. I told you to compare this with the first layer, because in the first layer also there was muscle to the great toe as well as little toe, but in the first layer there were abductors and here there are flexors. Okay, and there's one more with respect to the hallucis, that is adductor hallucis. You can see a transverse head and oblique head of adductor hallucis muscle. Okay, so these three muscles are here. And for nerve supply, again we can remember which muscle is medial. This flexor hallucis brevis is on the medial aspect, so that will be supplied by medial plantar nerve. Okay, other muscles are supplied by lateral plantar nerve. Okay, so this was the muscles along the third layer of the sole of the foot. So now let's cover about the muscles of the fourth layer of the sole of foot. So there are seven muscles in the fourth layer. There is three plantar interossei and four dorsal interossei. Okay, in the upper limb we have learnt about palmar interossei. Corresponding muscles in the lower limb are plantar introsciae, okay, and there are four dorsal introsciae. Attachments we can see. The plantar introsciae gets attached along the lateral three metatarsals, okay, sides of the lateral three metatarsals, and dorsal introsciae gets attached along the adjacent surface of all metatarsals, and dorsal introsciae is always seen as a bipinnate muscle, okay. And if you see the nerve supply, all seven muscles are supplied by the lateral plantar nerve, okay. So if you see nerve supply of the muscles of the sole of foot, major muscles or maximum muscles are supplied by lateral plantar nerve, except few muscles which are along the medial aspect, those will be supplied by medial plantar nerve, okay. So we have covered all the muscles in the lower limb, okay. So let's summarize what we have covered in this particular session. We started with the muscles of the anterior compartment of the thigh, seven muscles. Four muscles are quadriceps femoris, then there is one sartorius, then tensor fascia lata and articularis genu. Then three muscles in the group, vertebro iliofemoral, sos major, sos minor and iliacus. Then medial compartment of the thigh, six muscles, the three adductor muscles, adductor longus, brevis, magnus, then gracilis, pectineus and obturator externus, these are the other three. Then posterior compartment of the thigh, three muscles are semitendinosus, semimembranosus and biceps femoris muscle. Okay. And we learnt about the characteristics of hamstring muscles. Also, ischial part of adductor magnus is included in posterior compartment of the thigh. Okay. Then in the gluteal region, we learnt eight muscles, the gluteus maximus, medius, minimus, then piriformis muscle, which is actually referred to as the key muscle of the gluteal region. And after that, obturator internus with two gamelli, quadratus femoris. Okay. So all these muscles we covered in gluteal region. Then in anterior compartment of the leg, four muscles. Those muscles are tibialis anterior, then extensor digitorum longus, extensor hallucis longus, and fibularis tertius. Then lateral compartment of the leg, two muscles are fibularis longus and fibularis brevis. Then posterior compartment of the leg, there are three superficial muscles and four deep muscles. Three superficial include gastrocnemius, soleus, and plantaris. Four deep include tibialis posterior, flexor digitorum longus, flexor hallucis longus, and popliteus muscle. Okay. Then in the dorsum of the foot, one muscle, that is extensor digitorum brevis, and in the sole of the foot, there were 18 muscles which we covered in groups of four layers. Okay. So in all, there are 59 muscles in the lower limb. So this was all about this particular session. So if you all have any feedback, you can put in the comments section below, and also do join here on these platforms. Okay. Thank you.